Hello everyone, I'm Haralambos Gavrilidis, or short Harry, and I will talk about scaling a public transport monitoring system to Internet of Things infrastructures. So first we're going to look at how a public transport system can be modeled as an IoT scenario and what data management challenges this brings with it. Then we're going to introduce Nebula Stream, an end-to-end data management system for the IoT. Finally, we're going to show our demonstration, which is a real-time monitoring application for a public transport system. So in a simplified view, a public transport consists of vehicles that follow predefined routes and carry sensors with them that report several measurements such as temperature, passenger flow, or vehicle occupancy. On the other hand, we have potential passengers that look for options to commute. So if we place those sensors in a geospatial context, we have things that are geographically distributed and constantly move. If we combine those things with the rest of the infrastructure, which is, let's say, base stations or the cloud and applications, we have what we call the Internet of Things, or short IoT. So in the IoT, devices are heterogeneous. They range from low-end devices such as sensors and Raspberry Pis to high-end devices such as cloud nodes with multi-core architectures and GPUs. And also network connections are heterogeneous. On the, let's say, fog layer, connections are unstable and might be also wireless. And on the cloud layer, we have high-speed interconnects. So IoT applications usually need real-time processing of the resulting sensor streams that come from the topology. So if we put all those things together now, we will see that we have vehicles and passengers that send their data to their assigned base stations. Base stations are geographically distributed as well. So their sensor streams go through the base stations to the cloud, are enriched with external data sources, and finally reach the applications. So how does a data management system actually cope with such an infrastructure? So as we said, real-time applications need data analytics on incoming data streams from geographically distributed and moving data sources. And these streams can be processed on, again, geographically distributed and heterogeneous nodes all over the infrastructure. So cloud-based approaches would leverage existing stream processing engines such as Apache Flink or Apache Spark. So this would scale the computation on the cloud, but it would leave all other nodes unused. Fog-based solutions will tackle this problem and, let's say, process the data closer to the sensor, but it will leave out the scaling capabilities of the cloud. Nebula Stream tries to bridge this gap by providing an end-to-end solution that scales on the whole infrastructure and utilizes all available resources. So this is a high-level overview of the components of Nebula Stream. For more information, I would point you to our recent CIDR publication. So essentially, external services can submit queries to NES, which is it optimizes through its optimizer and topology manager, then deploys them on the topology with its deployment manager, and then it writes back the results to the external services. So the application we built on top of NES, Nebula Stream, we call it NES for short, consists of a web server and user interfaces. So a user can in step one submit a query or a request through the interactive map to the web server. The web server will translate this user request to a Nebula Stream query, which will be sent to the NES coordinator through its REST interface. Then Nebula Stream will optimize and deploy the query as discussed before, and it will write the result to a sync, which is in our case a message queue that is consumed by the web server in step six. And finally, in step seven, the web server will forward the resulting data stream to the corresponding user. So our front end is an interactive map that allows, let's say, three data management operations, which are filtering, clustering, and detecting underserved areas. So to the user interface, the user can set clustering parameters and view usage statistics. And for this demonstration purposes, we use the VBB data set that is provided by Berlin's public transport company and integrated with synthetic passenger movement data that we generated with the Sumo tool. Let us now switch to the front end. Let me now guide you through our application's front end. So our front end consists of this interactive map and this configuration panel where users can define their queries. So right now we have no query running, but to do that, let's move the map and let's say we go to Ernst-Reuter-Platz where TU Berlin is located. This movement will already fire the first query and potential passengers, which are green markers, will start appearing on our map. So if we want to include more points in the map, we can select some of these vehicle types here. So now we can see tram and metro vehicles next to our potential passengers. So we can also cluster these points by enabling this DBScan clustering option. DBScan has two parameters. The one is the maximum distance between two points, and the second one is the minimal samples per cluster. So we can see here we have nice clusters, small clusters. I can also change the parameters of DBScan and set the maximum distance to a higher value, and this will lead to bigger clusters. So we can see in our stats panel that we only have six clusters right now. Okay, so we can also detect underserved areas. So what this will do, within a cluster, it will calculate the ratio between vehicles and potential passengers, and if it is below a certain threshold, it will yield let's say red markers, else the markers stay green. So we can see here we have, let's say, this underserved cluster here and here. So by moving the map again, I will have, let's say, a new bounding box. So I will have a new query with more points in it. And yeah, we see the underserved areas here. So now that the vehicle entered here, this cluster became not underserved. So the points are green. And now that it will leave, I guess it will become also underserved at some point. Yeah, we can see that here. So our application also offers to give hints to the NES optimizer about the execution mode. So as we can see, NES filters out already records that are not within the bounding box. And by setting this execution mode, we can give hints to NES on where on this infrastructure to actually filter those records. So NES would actually decide it by itself. But yeah, for this application's purposes, we included the buttons here. So now let me go back to our slides to conclude this presentation. Summing up, in our demonstration, we showcased a representative IoT scenario through a public transport monitoring application. In our presentation, we highlighted that data management systems face several challenges in the geo-distributed and heterogeneous IoT landscape. We gave a brief overview of Nebula Stream and discussed how it unifies sensor, fog, and cloud nodes into a single end-to-end system. For more information about the Nebula Stream project, please visit our website under nebula.stream. With that, I would like to finish this presentation. Thank you for your attention.